motion to approve the minutes held on January 30th.
So moved.
Second, any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, then the minutes are approved. On tab two, that'll be, this section will be deferred until the next meeting. And we'll move right to tab three. To consider the establishment of a minority business support initiative, and Daniela will give that presentation.
Hey, everyone. So we have in front of you today, you'll recall that recently we requested approval for two grants to the Rhode Island Business Association and the Rhode Island University School of Law. Those were pass-throughs that were allocated through a total $6 million Minority Business Accelerator. Is, I think, officially what the statute calls it, but we've been internally calling the Minority Business Support Initiative. So a full $6 million allocated in the FY23 budget, and that REBA and Roger Williams School of Law grants were a component of that $6 million. We're coming to you today to request authorization for the remainder, the rest of the $5.2 million of that program, because it's not a program that's run through our standard operating budget and standard statutory obligations. We come to you for each of these programs, as we had with the rebounds programs for the 22 budget, as separate and standalone requests for authorization to engage in the work. So the $5.2 million is, as I said, it's SFRF, so State Fiscal Recovery Fund dollars funded, and will be broken up into sort of five main categories. The first is the big bulk, and is supporting intermediary-based programming, so technical assistance, access to space, things like that, through our business-serving organizations. Another big chunk, that would be $3 million out of the program. The second big chunk is $1.2 million out of the program to create a direct grant program for our minority businesses in state. And then another set of funds for technical assistance, $300,000. That would be additive to the technical assistance program that you previously approved under rebounds, and specific for those businesses that are not eligible for TA through that other program, either because they don't, they've already received other funds, or they don't qualify due to size or other things. So that there'd be a space for them to also be able to access that technical assistance. And then the fourth bucket, rather, is additional program business support organization training at $200,000, and then the remainder of the dollars are to support a staff member and the compliance and things that we need to do for the program. And we're excited. We're really bullish that you'll approve this tonight, because we've gotten someone to say yes to being our program manager, and so we're really excited to be able to get her to start with us. We've got Linda Urizar-Mendez here with us tonight, and get her to be able to start with us and run this whole work. Linda comes to us most recently from the city of Providence and was a RIC, as well as Harvard University alum, and has both private sector work as well as city-based work with Providence. We're really excited to have Linda join and be able to launch this program hopefully after today. Any questions?
Hearing none, we take the motion.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion on the motion?
No.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that passes. Thank you, Danielle. Tab four, to consider an extension of the contract with the Convention, Sports, and Leisure. Jeff Miller, thanks, Jeff.
Hi, good afternoon. Convention, Sports, and Leisure was our consultant when we were evaluating first McCoy Stadium and then the Tidewater Stadium. And you approved their contract and all that a couple of years back. They were valuable partners during the process in evaluating the stadium project, the program, the costs, and the economic impact analysis. We don't have an immediate need for CSL right now, but I think it's always valuable to have them on our bench if we need them in the future, so we'd like to have the board consider renewing them for another period of time.
Questions? Good. No questions. I'll take a motion.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Any discussion on the motion? Hear none? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None opposed, that passes as well. Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Tab five, consider an amendment to the contract with O'Neill Consulting Group for executive search services. Danielle, you're up.
It's the end of February, but it feels like Groundhog Day. We're back, and we're hopeful that this will be the last time we come back to you for this particular type of request. But we are seeking to once more extend our engagement with O'Neill. They are an executive search firm we've used for 11 positions over the last couple of years. 9 of those are filled already, and the most recent board meeting, we asked you to extend the contract with O'Neill, particularly to support hiring for an HR manager. We're hopeful that adding some capacity to our HR team will be able to alleviate some of this need moving forward. But in the immediate, we have a very pressing need for 2 roles within what was previously our PTAC program, so our program that supports federal procurement, or government procurement in general, so local, state, and federal. I say previously because they just rebranded to the APEX, so get PTAC out of your brains now, it is now the APEX program nationally. But we need a director of the APEX program as well as a counselor, and we've had a hard time filling our counselor role for some time, but we also have a very exciting promotion that's happened within our team, opening up the role for the PTAC or the APEX director, and so hoping that we can bring O'Neill in. And so seeking to extend this contract by $6,000 to be able to support those 2 roles. And then by then, hopefully we'll have our HR manager and be able to take this and run with it. And for anyone interested in how that's going, we've got 3 finalist interviews this week. So I also hope that we'll have some good information on that role coming up to the next board meeting. So that's been a good process for us working with O'Neill on that particular hire.
Not to foul things up by asking questions, I hope this won't take too long. But in terms of the hiring that you're doing, have you had specific objectives around diversity, equity, inclusion? And how are you doing with that?
We always seek to push to make sure that we're getting the roles out to a diverse candidate pool. When we anyone we interview, we always make sure we track who we're interviewing and assess whether we've got a diverse candidate pool in terms of who we're interviewing. Should we always be pushing to do more of that? And do we need to kind of keep this front of mind as we continue to hire? Yes.
Now, what have we done in terms of hiring? Do you have any sense of whether your hiring has reflected that in terms of the people who are involved?
Somewhat. I'll say a couple of our recent hires, Barry in the corner, Melinda on the side of our room, and some of our other recent hires, saying like who's the most recent of all the staff we're here. Lindsay, Martha, she's not in the room though, is she? I'm just thinking we've sort of, yes, but could we be doing better? Always.
Thank you. Danielle, I was curious, you said that the firm helped with 9 employees. How long have they been, are they still working with the 9 that they're identified as anybody transitioned out because it wasn't a good fit? I'm just curious how satisfied you've been with the 9 folks that have been brought forward.
It's a great question. One has transitioned out, but the others are kicking the drum with us.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions, comments? Hearing none, I'll take a motion to approve.
So moved.
Any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, that passes. Thank you, Daniela. Stay right there. To receive an update on broadband initiatives.
All right. So Brenda's and a couple others for making sure that we're keeping you updated on the broadband work, but also we like to do this, at each meeting come with an update on one of our different programs.
we've made the joke recently when Liz started, she asked, can I get just a one pager on all of our programs? And the one pager with like 10-point font with one line came out to 3 pages. So it's good to kind of keep these cycles going of everything that's going on. We have a huge amount of money coming into the state, but there is a timeline for all of this. So thus far, since establishing the program under the FY23 budget, we've published a state broadband strategic plan, which unlocked and allowed us to come in to apply for and receive, totaling thus far $5.5 million in federal funds to support planning and the build out of a grant program, or a couple grant programs that we'll be administering. We've worked with partners like Skills for Rhode Island's Future, and we've started to bring together our broadband advisory committee. We had our first meeting of that committee in November, and we have our next meeting scheduled for March 7th. And then we've also worked with a lot of the behind the scenes stuff that needs to happen before we can most smartly deploy dollars and resources. And a lot of that has been in our mapping work. So that's understanding the many levels of infrastructure that we need to deeply know, and infrastructure as well as people, where they are, who they are, what they need, and align what we know in the state and what we see in the state with what the federal government has, because ultimately our reporting is going to need to be done to them, and what we see has to match with what they see. And so, you know, we've submitted so far 3 rounds of challenge to the FCC, who are the ones designing the maps that are used for dollar allocation, and submitted 38,000 location challenges. This is, you know, folks like hotels in Block Island that they didn't realize were buildings. You know, like going through this and at that layer of granularity, saying, you're missing that house, you're missing this business. There are 5 funding streams that we're pulling together for this work. There's the BEAD program, the Broadband Equity Access and Deployment Program. That's $100 million, and this is where I noted we got our first $5 million of that. In a second, I'll show you there's a process for unlocking each of these dollars. We don't just get the $100 million off the jump. The second program is the Capital Projects Fund. That's an additional $25 million run through a different federal agency. So when you talk about sort of layers of complexity here, we're talking 3 at minimum different federal agencies that we're operating with right now. And we are awaiting that award. U.S. Treasury has admitted publicly that they are slow. They are seeking to get all of these broadband awards out specifically first. They've gotten 30 states done so far, and so we're expecting to be pretty soon. They keep telling us pretty soon, but they've had, talk about staff turnover, everyone that we've worked with at the beginning when we submitted our proposal now is gone. So we've got all new folks trying to get up to speed on things. The third funding stream is the Digital Equity Act. So that is dollars specific for digital equity and inclusion. We've been awarded $500,000 to support planning for that, and that will trigger, once we submit our plan, that will trigger access to additional dollars for implementation. Things like device access and digital literacy trainings, but also you know, equitable infrastructure and equitable connectivity generally. And then the last two are quicker, but there's a program for folks to be aware of. The ACP is a $30 a month subsidy for anyone who qualifies. If you are a Pell Grant recipient, or you qualify for any, you know, SNAP, TANF, any federal programs, you qualify for ACP. And there's a grant that we applied to, we believe, we put in for about $750,000. We're hopeful that we'll get at least $500,000. We're talking to folks through the FCC that grant's coming through to support awareness of that program. We last we have crunched the numbers. It's only about 1/4 of, we think, eligible Rhode Islanders are taking advantage of this program, so we really need to get the word out about it more, and we're hoping that those dollars can help specifically with that. And then the last bucket of money was the SFRF funding. We've got Ethan here from House who knows that came through in FY22, and we're completed our KPIs for that effort, and we're just spending down the final dollars for that work.
Daniela, how much will the Digital Equity Act cover once? You didn't mention that, what the larger figure will be for that.
I didn't, because I don't know.
Okay.
So it's 100 for the BEAD, 25 for capital projects, and that one is based on an allocation, a formula that they haven't run yet. And I've heard everything in $1 million to $5 million to, like, it's very all over the place, and so we're kind of just waiting. I don't want to get my hopes up on some number that's not going to come through.
Thank you.
But it is a formula allocation. So right now we're working on getting an RFP out to bring on support. So we'll come back to you with that to bring on support for development of our full grant programs and deployment of that. We're hiring right now, so to go back to hiring, if anyone knows a great grants administrator or anyone, please let us know that. Just reminding me that I should get the hook, timer's up. We have our next advisory committee meeting on March 7th, and we're continuing to do our mapping work and stakeholder engagement. So we have a survey and a speed test open on our website right now, so we can gather information on affordability, what people are experiencing for speeds, and things like that. So the last two slides that I have, one is just sharing that we do have our council set up, so I wanted to share who's on our council, representative from, as you know, baked into statute. And then very quickly, and I'm not gonna run through this, but largely what I wanted to note here is sort of the timeline generally for what you're seeing. And sort of from 22, you can tell some of the work we've done so far, but 22, 23 is really about planning, and 24, 25 out through 28 is gonna be implementation. And the dollars come in tranches based on certain milestones that we have to hit. So that strategic plan that we did is that first milestone to unlock our 5 million. Next up, we've got this five-year action plan that's due in August. That'll allow us to trigger the application for the next 20 million. And then once we do our work to spend down the next 20 million, we'll be able to get our next chunk of change. So just using this timeline to show that this will be multi-year, and really this whole year is gonna be set for planning. We'll start our implementation work. That's all I've got.
Great. Any questions, comments?
Yeah. I have a comment. I really just wanted to commend you, Liz and Daniela, for all of the efforts on the broadband expansion. This is just such an important opportunity. There's a lot of money for a small state for Rhode Island. And so we have to be really thoughtful about the process. And I appreciate the update and hope you can continue to be updated, and anything we can do from our various perspectives to support this work. Rely on us to help to make sure the information gets out, because this is a very important initiative.
I'll tell you, we've been working on this for years, even before we knew these dollars were coming, so it played in very nicely to say, oh, we know exactly what we want to need, because we've been talking about it for several years. So for this to come, it's been perfectly.
Yeah, they've made their marks, so I'm out there talking to people. They know Daniela very well, for good reasons, so thank you for that. With that as well, and the many, many areas, this is going to be very critical, not only in the business, the connectivity issue. I was on the call with the White House this week about freeing up some dollars that have been already appropriated for an education program that we're going to start, that's going to kind of move us from a traditional 180-day of learning experience to 365 days. Connectivity, I was going to talk to you about that, Danielle. The connectivity is a piece of, you know, the piece that we need to kind of weave into the mix on that distribution of dollars. So it's going to be really very, very important to continue this work. And at the White House too, they certainly mentioned that Rhode Island is one of the most connected states on a per capita basis in the country. So we started in a really good spot, but as to your point, let's keep on moving ahead in a way that helps our economy and helps the people that live in the state.
Yeah, there's also workforce dollars, these funds, which I think will be very helpful to make sure that we have the expansion. Liz knows this, but doing a lot of work with the Department of Corrections to make sure that folks who are incarcerated also have access to technology for workforce and education. So I think it's really exciting.
Put that into our budget, and I know Whitnick Island is knocking on the door, so just, we're continually aware of this. Even last night I was in Newport, and the discussion came up on that as well. So keep up the good work, and thank you very much. I echo the board's feelings on that. All right, before we do the adjournment, I want to just mention that I've asked Liz Carducci to be a vice chair, because we're going to need a vice chair just in case I'm not around at any moment in time, so or I have to kind of remove myself from the hearing for any reason. So thank you for doing that. And then also, I do, I think you've heard, which is really another, I think, an indication that our Commerce Board and as well as our Commerce Department is doing the work, $61 million appropriation for small business targeted at primarily your minority-owned businesses and your woman-owned businesses. Announced this week, about half of that's going to go into a loan strategy, and about half of that's going to go into an incubator or an accelerator strategy. And we're talking not only inside of how to distress that, to leverage that, but we're also talking to higher education institutions. I was with Bryant University the other day with the president, talking about this very issue about how to create these accelerators and would they participate, and they will. So you got a lot of good momentum going on against the backdrop of a slowdown potentially, but we'll be ready. Either way, we'll be ready, and these type of things happen, you know, make that happen. So thank you so much. I'll take the motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All in opposed, we are adjourned. Thank you very much.